Hi everybody, welcome to Chatterbox Quilts Live. It is March 21st, 2019. Happy spring to everyone. And thanks so much for joining me live today. Or if you're watching the replay, thanks for taking the time to watch the replay as well. If this is your first time here, you may not know who I am. So let me explain who I am. I'm Kim Jamieson-Hirst. My business is called Chatterbox Quilts. And through my business, I try and help you with quilting information and tips. And I do that via live streams such as this, through my YouTube channel, and also through my private membership called The Quilter's Way. So if you are here watching me, please say hello and let me know that you are here. And let me just make sure I can see all of you as well. I can see some of you are here already. So let me just pull up my information so I can see you in the chat. Because otherwise it gets rather boring if I'm talking to myself all the time. So just give me one second here. We're always updating software, so that sometimes throws me off just a little bit. Okay, here we go. All right. So I see Sarah is here. Thanks for joining me today. I'm sure we'll have a few more people coming up, but while we're waiting, let me just tell you a little bit about The Quilter's Way if you haven't heard of it before. It's a monthly membership and it's a private group. It's not on Facebook, it's totally private. And in that, we combine learning via videos and other downloads, informational sheets, and we combine a very active and fun community. So, much like we're doing today with a live stream, we do that a couple of times a month with them in what we call Zoom meetings, where members can see one another and converse with one another and ask questions and get answers. And that's really one of the great features of The Quilter's Way, is the community part of it. It's that interaction between quilters. It's the ability to ask a question and get a specific answer. It's the ability to tell me what you'd like to see, and we can create courses or video training for you. So if you're interested in The Quilter's Way, and it's only $12 US a month, which is less than the cost of a pattern here in Canada, you can do that by going to thequiltersway.com. Okay, so let me talk about what I have to cover today. I have a whole bunch of different things. I'm going to switch cameras today so you can see me here. And let me just move this over a little bit so you can see me better. So first off, I wanted to say, if you are one of the members of my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group and you're watching me today, you're one of my chatties, hi guys, and a special shout out to any of my Quilter's Way members who may be watching as well. They'll be with me tomorrow afternoon live, but sometimes they like to come in and watch on these videos as well. So if you guys are there, say hello. And let me get into the topics I want to discuss today. So one of the ones I wanted to talk about today is about my latest Janome sewing machine. So if you know me, or you've known me for a while, you know I'm a Janome Canada artisan, and I use Janome sewing machines. And I recently got a newer model, which is the Janome MC9450. Now there's a 9400 and then there's a 9450, which is sort of an updated version, if you will, of the 9400. And I've done lots of videos for the 9400, which people are really finding helpful for them. And I get into all the specifics on the machine. But what I'm wondering is, if you have a 9450 or you're interested in a 9450, you're wondering about it, would you like to see videos done on the 9450, like all the different screens and the different features that it has, or would you like to only see what's different from the 9400? So if you'd like to see, you know, how to do applique, you know, get into the applique mode on the machine, how to get into free motion quilting mode, that type of thing, on the 9450, specifically on that machine, give me a yes, if it pertains to you, of course. If you are happy to look at the 9400 videos and kind of, you know, figure out how it works on the 9450, because it's similar, say no. And then I'll know, because I'm filming. I've already done some filming with the 9450, which is what you see under its cover over here. But I'm just wondering whether I should be redoing some of those previous videos so they are specifically done on the 9450. I see we have Trish Ann coming in here, and as well as Sarah watching us too. Another sunny spring day there. We are having beautiful weather here in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. Finally, after probably the worst February on record as far as cold temperatures. So we are enjoying the beautiful spring weather here too, higher than normal. So we've been colder than normal in some months, and now we're hotter than normal because normally we don't get the temperatures we're getting right now yet. But I'm not complaining. Okay, so again, if it pertains to you with the 9400 or the 9450 and you're watching on the replay too, because I know some of you do, just give me a yes if you'd like new videos on the 9450 or know if you're going to just watch ones on 9400 and figure out how it would go on the 9450. Okay, next thing I wanted to talk about is quilt blocks. In my Chatterbox Quilts group, I was asking people about what their favorite quilt blocks were. And there was a variety of suggestions, of course, and they're all pieced blocks, of course. But what I found was that there were some that keep coming up over and over again. So some of the ones I heard coming up over and over again were ones to do with triangles, so like, or half square triangles. So pinwheel blocks, for example, a very traditional favorite with a lot of people. Storm at sea, that's a little more complicated block, gorgeous block, you do lots of things with that block too. Let's see what else we had here. We had strip piece blocks or scrap blocks and log cabin too. Now, I've got to say that I like to do things with half-square triangles. I love half-square triangles as well. And so you could say pinwheel blocks. Those work with the half-square triangles, of course. And I like strip piece blocks because they're easy to do. And I love log cabin blocks, too. So they were hitting all my favorites as well. And while I like log cabin blocks, I've never really done a log cabin quilt, which is interesting. I keep looking at them in all the different settings, and I think one of the reasons I like the log cabin blocks so much and the strip piece blocks is because there are so many possibilities with settings. Pinwheels too, really. Anything with half square triangles. You know, you can put a bunch of half square triangles together in all kinds of different arrangements and get some really cool and different looks. So I love blocks where you can take the block and turn them different ways and put them with other blocks, with the same block, let's say, but in different orientations is what I'm trying to say. And you get a totally different look. So I'm sure you've seen the different settings with log cabins. So if you guys have favorite quilt blocks, let me know what they are. Just put them in the comments because I'm wondering too. I'm waiting for something really different to come up that I haven't heard of before. And then I can go off and explore it and go down another rabbit hole. Like I don't have enough I can do that with already. But Luann has joined us as well. Thank you, Luann. She's got a 9400. So she's all set up with her videos there. I'm sure you've watched some of them, Luann, as well. Okay, let's see what else. So tell me what you like for pieced blocks. And I wanted to talk about what you're seeing behind me. Everything's the opposite to me. Behind me here, you see my little buddy Star up there, my little horse, and my Yahoo banner because we are on day 4 of the Wrangle Your Scraps Challenge. So some of you may know what I'm talking about. If you don't, it's a 5-day challenge. We're on day 4, so we're almost done. And it is a challenge where every day you get a new thing to do, a new challenge, and you get a video that day where I'm going to walk you through how to do it and other suggestions for, you know, what you can do that day, some more information. So we are already almost at the end, and the whole point of this challenge was to delve into your fabric scraps, get them sorted out, get rid of pieces that were too small to be usable or you didn't like anymore, and there's lots of different things you can do with those too. They don't have to go in the garbage. And then you're going to be able to sort them out, and we offer different suggestions on how to do that. Cut them up, yes or no, we talk about that. Get them into storage containers. That's what today is about. We're talking about different choices for storage containers. And of course, my go-to place for any kind of storage container, anything in my studio, is IKEA. If you know me, that's where I get most of my things from. And then tomorrow we have another topic, which I won't say yet because it's not out yet. But we started on Monday and it finishes tomorrow. So there is a Facebook group that went along with that challenge too. So members or subscribers to that challenge, I should say, are in there and they've got all their photos of where they're starting and how they're moving along. And it's like, wow, it's amazing. So while I thought that some people who had a lot of scraps, and some of these people have a lot of scraps, that they would just tackle maybe, you know, a small portion of them, work through the challenge, learn, you know, and decide how they're going to manage their scraps, and then go back and tackle the rest of them. No, no, no. Most of these people are diving right in, and they've got all their scraps laid out, and they've got bags and bins and all kinds of things. There's some really interesting storage containers that some of them are using right now. Probably the most interesting one is, the plastic dog bowls. Like you got the two, you know, you have water in one and food in the other. She has a dog bowl set up like that, and she has little tiny pieces that she sorts out in there, and she uses them for leaders and enders when she's stitching, which is quite funny. So anything can be used to store your fabric scraps, and that's probably the most interesting one I've seen, but hey, think about it, right? Usually they have, you know, non-skid on the bottom of them, like rubber or something. You could have them right next to your machine and just a little piece, you just pick them up and, you know, one at the start, one at the end, and just, it would be really easy to use. A good idea, actually, really good idea. So if you guys are interested in the Wrangle Your Scraps, or if you're in the Wrangle Your Scraps, let me know if you are. There's quite a few people in there, so I can't keep track of quite everybody. But that is something that, as I said, started Monday, it finishes tomorrow. So if you didn't have the opportunity to join now and you're interested in that challenge, we'll be offering it later this year. And if you're in the Quilter's Way, the challenges are always free. They get access to the challenges in there and they can go back over them anytime they want. If you're outside the membership, there's a fee to join those challenges. But as I say, if you didn't get the opportunity now and you're interested, or maybe you're a new quilter and you don't have a lot of fabric scraps yet, but in say 6 months you will, trust me, you will, and you might be interested, just keep an eye on my Facebook page or in my group if you're in my Chatterbox Quilts group, because we'll be doing that challenge later this year. It's been lots of fun, actually, and has helped me get some of mine in order, but I have a lot more to sort. And if you're a scrap quilter, give me a yes in the comments, because the interesting thing, I think, when you're working with scraps, they're lots of fun to work with, and if you put a whole bunch together, they always seem to look great, doesn't matter what style or color they are. But the really interesting thing I think about them is the fact that even though I will use, like I was using a lot of my scraps for strip piece blocks, that scrap pile never seems to go down. I don't know what it is. I think I need to set up hidden cameras at night to see what goes on in those scrap bins, because you think, you know, you've got all these blocks you've made and yet there's still all these scraps left over. So it's really interesting. But it's a great way to use up your scraps in strip piecing or other blocks. You can use them in all different kinds of projects, of course. And if you like to do applique like I do, you can use even little tiny pieces of fabric. They come in really handy too. So I read someone was saying that, you know, even the scraps that you have, those are still money, right? You paid for them. They're just a bigger piece to start with. So you want to get your money's worth out of your fabric, get those scraps set up, and so then you can use them in a future quilt project. Alrighty, let's see what else we wanted to talk about today. Oh, I know something else. This is interesting. Again, I'm keep going back into my group because there's a lot of interesting things that have been coming up in the Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group recently. And I asked people, it's interesting, when I ask a question, the type of response I think is going to come back isn't always what comes back, so it always surprises me. So I asked in the group, if you ever thought about starting a craft business, you know, whether it's quilting or crochet or knitting or jewelry making or whatever it may be, have you ever thought about starting a business like that? And if so, what stopped you? So of course, my mind goes to online teaching because that's what I do. But most people's mind went to actually making, let's say, a quilt and selling it at a craft show or trade fair or someplace like that. So actually making the product and selling it. Well, if you've ever tried to do that, and I think most of us probably have tried that to some degree or made things for, you know, church bazaars or that type of thing, it's really time consuming and you don't make a lot of money at it, really. So if you're making a quilt, first off, it's difficult to get people to pay what the cost of fabric is, let alone your time in it as well. But I think it's, if you don't value your, I don't mean value your time, if you don't put a price on your time, and you say, well, it took me 3 hours to make this little quilt, let's say, and I sold it for $50. Well, if you start backtracking and take off how much it cost for the fabric and the batting and the thread and da-da, and then you're going to find out that you got paid nothing for your time. So if you're looking at it, if you're just doing it because, you know, some people like to do, make those things, as I say, put them in to raise money for different charities or groups or whatever, that's great because your time is your volunteer time, right? But if you're looking at it to make money, I think most people find it extremely difficult to make money that way unless you have some kind of a system to mass produce the items that you're trying to sell. So my next thought is, have you ever thought about teaching online? And I don't think most people really grasp the concept of what I mean when I say that. So, or they just, it's outside their realm of thinking, I suppose, right? And I think a lot of people think it's really difficult to do. And I always say it's not hard to do if you're willing to work hard. So it's these days with the internet and smartphones. I mean, I'm using a camera. I'm using either my webcam, or I have a separate camera set up here. Sometimes I have a couple of cameras set up depending on what I'm doing. So yes, it's cost me some money to get those cameras, but you do not have to do that when you're first starting off. If you want to record yourself teaching someone to quilt or teaching someone to crochet or make jewelry, you can use the video function on your smartphone because it works really, really well. You don't even have to necessarily film yourself depending on what you're doing. You could take really good detailed up-close pictures and put them in a slideshow format. Depends on what you're doing. There's lots of different options. So if you've ever thought about doing that, or if right now you're thinking, huh, I never thought about that, that sounds interesting, give me a yes in the comments to let me know, because I think it would be something that a lot of my viewers could get into, make some money at it. I think they'd enjoy the process, and being online, you connect with other creators who are online too, which is really interesting, and you can learn a lot. But the nice thing is that it's inexpensive to do. It is, you know, you can use, like, YouTube is free. If you want to put your videos out on YouTube just to share with people, you could do that. You can even have a paid portal in YouTube where people will pay to watch your videos or download them. And there are all these, there's just a lot of different options. But you can do it quite inexpensively to start and see if you like it or not. And being on camera does take a bit of practice, but it's not difficult. And trust me, there are a lot of people out there who are doing, you know, doing videos all the time, and they're not really concerned about how good things look, or, you know, all you have to do is think about some of the younger generation and some of the videos that they produce, and they're just on the spot, on the fly. You could be doing videos of yourself at a quilt show or something like that to start with, or at a trade show, or, you know, in your favorite quilt shop, buying things, in your studio working. It's not hard. And live streaming like this, even though I'm using additional software, you can live stream through YouTube, you can live stream through Facebook, and it's all free too. So, just something to think about. I see we have Rob joining us. Hey Rob. Rob, one of my members in the Quilter's Way. Rob actually manages my machine embroidery group that we have in the Quilter's Way, thank goodness, because his skills are much better than mine on any kind of embroidery machine. So glad that you were able to catch us today, because with the time difference, it's at night for him. Trish is answering my previous question where I asked about what kind of quilt block she likes. What's her favorite? Log cabin. Modified to resemble Waffle House. Waffle House? Okay, a favorite restaurant in the South. Yes, you better post some pictures there so I can see what that looks like. That is kind of cool. So little, she's got here, little tiny houses or log cabins. So you're using the log cabins to make the little houses, I think, is what you're talking about. Maybe we got to see what that looks like later on. So that'll be in my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group, I think, is what you're talking about, Trish. Trish Ann, I should say. So that sounds interesting. I'll have to see that. Yes, Waffle House sounds familiar. Even though I'm not in the South, it sounds familiar. So who doesn't like waffles, right? All right. So just something to think about when I was talking about if you've ever thought about teaching online. Might be something you might be interested in. If so, you can always send me a message and ask more questions. I have a lot of information on that type of thing. And then I get to something, my favorite part, where I get to talk about myself. No, I'm just kidding. But one, I asked for suggestions for topics for YouTube videos because I like to know what people are interested in, what kind of things they'd like to see that they haven't already seen on my channel. So it's a really good source of topics for me. And one person said, What about your background? Well, I don't really want to do a YouTube video on my background, although this live will be up on YouTube later, but people can skip that part if they want. But I guess some people may not know my background or where I come from or how I got to where I am right now in front of you. So I started quilting probably about 15 years ago or so. I didn't start when I was younger. Nobody I knew quilted. And I saw some of my friends doing quilting. They had some wall hangings in their house I thought were pretty, and I actually helped a friend with a fusible web applique project, which if you've done fusible web applique and it's, you know, you're tracing backwards and it goes this way when it goes in the fabric, it's kind of confusing. I had no idea what we were doing here, except I was tracing things and I couldn't figure out what was going to happen. Little did I know it's become my favorite quilting technique. So I did that, and then I thought it was, you know, it was kind of interesting, and my other friend suggested, you know, why don't you take a course? So if you take a course, you'll either like it or you won't. And then before you, you know, spend any money on materials or buy quilting sewing machine, you can see if you like it. So I did. I took a weekend quilt shop, and actually was in a quilt course, I should say, and it was interesting because the Thursday night, I think the class ran all day Saturday and Sunday, but Thursday night, you actually went to the shop and they helped you pick out fabric. Now, we were making an Irish chain, kind of your traditional first quilt. And they actually, we needed, I think, three fabrics in that. I think the border was different. And they actually helped you pick out fabric so it would work well together, which was really helpful for a quilter who's just starting off and hasn't a clue. I mean, I had never looked at cottons really that much even. So to look at all these, you know, and the cottons you look at in a quilt shop are a lot different than what you'll see in a store that's selling them for garments, let's say. So that was quite an experience. And I took the class. It was great, really good instructor. Absolutely loved it, of course. And it's been just, you know, quilting ever since. And of course, a few years in, I thought I'd like to design some patterns because I never do exactly what's in front of me. I know many quilters are like this. And as I say, I like fusible web applique. So I started designing mostly fusible web applique patterns, which I still have available. They're on my website. But I did that for a few years and sold those. And then I was doing YouTube videos, I guess, because you got to think about, you know, back then where the internet was at and how things were coming along, right? So once things started becoming more readily accessible via the internet, then I jumped on them. So I've been doing YouTube videos for about 9 years now, I guess. At the time, I was doing patterns at the same time as I was doing YouTube videos. And I also was doing some patterns for magazines. So Quilters Connection magazine, which I've got over here actually, a new issue just came out, Canadian magazine. Did some for them. I did some articles for them. I did some articles for Country Register, which is published around Canada, North America really. Did some articles, patterns I should say, for Irish quilting as well. So did some of that. That was fun. And then I was doing more YouTube. I started doing some quilt alongs. I collaborated with some quilt designers and some authors. Did a few quilt alongs. Those were really fun. It's great to collaborate with other creative minds. And then I moved into doing online courses. I've done that through a variety of venues as well. And I started doing more work for Quilters Connection magazine. So I've had a column with them for over a year now. I think it's been probably close to 2 years now, actually, now I think about it. So I write a column every month called Reclaim the Joy. And that keeps me busy. And then finally, there was the ability to set up this membership online, which is the Quilters Way. And that is really a great venue for me. I love connecting with people there because we have a really active and fun community. And we also offer teaching. So I'm still doing online courses. They are just, for the most part, in the Quilters Way. Some we do sell outside if they are more pertinent to other parts of quilting than what we do in the Quilters Way. But I love to do that. We do challenges, that type of thing. Do live streams like this. That's another way of sharing information with people. So you can find me in a lot of different places. I'm all over the place on social media. Basically, I live online. Yes, I'm a real person, because you might wonder, but you find me mostly online, all the time, anywhere, it seems like, but mostly in the Quilters Way, because that's where I like to devote my attention to my members who are supporting me every month by paying their monthly fees, really. So that's sort of my background. It's been, I guess, about 15 years altogether, something like that, maybe a little bit longer, but it seems like really that it's gone by really fast. And we are constantly looking at more ways to connect with quilters, or more ways to collaborate with other quilters, other quilt designers, publishers, authors, you know, people who produce various quilting products. You'll see me doing reviews for different products that I believe in. And speaking of that type of thing, when I'm talking about connecting with other quilters, that is next, what is it, April the 5th, if you're in Alberta. April the 5th is the Central Alberta Quilters Guild annual show in Red Deer, Alberta, which is between Edmonton, which is the north part of the province, and Calgary, which is sort of middle south of the province. They're about 3 hours apart. And Red Deer is right in the middle, pretty much. So about an hour and a half out of Calgary. So I'm going to be there. I'll be there Friday. That's April 5th. So if you're going to be there, I'd love to meet you. I'll be hanging around there's a table area with like a little cantina, little eating area, lunch area. So I'll be in there around 1 o'clock. So if you're going to be there, pop in and do say hello, because I love chatting with people that know me online. And it would be great to see you there. I'll be there probably all day, I would think, for the most part. I'm there all day. And hopefully I'm not buying fabric, because I pledged not to buy fabric unless I need it for a project this year. So if you see me with fabric in my hand, you know, give me a little smack. Okay, just look here. Rob is waiting. He forgot I'm on daylight savings time or whatever we're on. I guess we're daylight savings time now. We had to change things. Jean, hi. It's good to see you here. Carla, too. Hey, Carla. So Carla's got a free minute because Carla's deep into scraps right now. I know. She's busy working on that scrap challenge, as is Rob. And as is Jean, too, I believe. Maybe some of the other ones as well. Like I said, there's a lot of people in there. But, yeah. So that's kind of my background. I do a lot of different things. I like to keep busy. I hate being bored. That is my worst thing. I do not like being bored at all, so I'm always doing something, usually quilting related. And besides that, I work part-time at a French immersion elementary school. So in the mornings I'm there, in the afternoons I'm here. So if you don't hear from me in the mornings, you email me, it's because I'm working outside the house. And then I come home. And then, of course, I've got, although no one's here today, two cats, Tika and Victor. They're both upstairs sleeping, I guess. They were mulling around for a while, but sometimes you see them in my videos behind me. So that's what I have. And I know some of you have pets as well. Most quilters have pets. So if you've got pets, let me know if you've got a dog or cat or what you have. Maybe you have something else. I don't know. I haven't seen anything more exotic than dogs or cats, really. I'm waiting to see something more exotic someday. So, you know, chameleons or some kind of lizard or something like that. I don't know. Could you imagine, right? Be perched on my shoulder while I'm quilting. Okay, when I was in university, my girlfriend had an iguana. Yeah, like about this big iguana. Not fun. Not fun when that thing's up on the curtains and you're wondering if it's going to drop on you. All right. So, anything on your guys' mind today? Any questions you have? Anything you're wondering about? If you're in the scrap challenge, if you have any questions, let me know about that. I think it's going along pretty smoothly. I'm seeing progress as people move through, which is really, really good. And I'm sure they're going to have lots of fabric ready for another project. Now, Rob is making binding out of his scraps, which is a great idea. Like, he was working on a project that was using jelly roll strips. So, you know, when you've got 2.5-inch strips already pre-cut for you, and you've got, you know, little bits left over, you just miter them, you know, stitch them together with a mitered seam, and then you've got, like, a multicolored binding to go around. That's a lot of fun, too. I save my binding ends separately. I have a bag of them. And I will do that for small projects, you know, kind of funky little projects. Put that multi-fabric binding on, and that's really cute. Adds, you know, adds some fun detail to the project. So that's a really good idea, I think, to do that. And I like to keep mine, you know, my bindings like kind of rolled up. And sometimes if I'm making, like, let's say mug rugs, so just a small project, I'll find that little bit of binding is enough that can go around the whole project. And that's kind of a bonus, I think. Last night, I should tell you, last night at our guild, I belong to a couple of guilds here in Calgary, and the one guild last night, we had an iron quilt challenge. So what that was four people on a team. We had, six or seven teams, and they were giving pre-cut, speaking of pre-cut fabric, they were given pre-cut fabrics because here in Calgary, well, in Canada, I know, but in Calgary, we have a chapter of Victoria's Quilts, and people donate fabric to them, and quilters make up little packages and give them to people like they did to our groups last night. And you make quilts, and we have long arm people in Calgary that bind them, and then they're giving to people who are undergoing treatment for cancer. So they were making these same pattern. They were making these quilt tops last night, and in between them working, so, you know, most of them had somebody stitching, there were other people that were cutting their chain piecing, they were cutting them apart, and somebody else was pressing, and then people were, you know, pinning them to go into rows and then put them up on design walls so they could figure out the arrangements, all this stuff. So it's lots of fun. And in between that, they were doing challenges. So, for example, one of their members had to take a spoon and a thimble in it, and they had to go around the area that we were in. They had to go all the way around a couple of times before, and the rest of their team members had to stop. They couldn't start quilting again until this person made it back. So they had a few little things like that. That was fun. And so at the end of the night, we had six quilt tops made, and it took about two and a half hours, I guess, about that to do it. It was amazing. It was really cool. And so I have one of the quilt tops here that I'm going to quilt for them, and then somebody else will bind it. They actually have binding with it too. They cut the binding and have the binding strips. They don't actually make it all together, but they've cut the 2.5-inch strips and have the binding. They give you the binding, all the fabric for the top, and they give you backing as well. So the long armers usually provide the batting. And then somebody, you know, will quilt it, and then somebody else will actually put the binding on and hand sew it down, and then it'll be given to someone. And they cannot keep up with the requests for quilts for people, which is a sad thing, but it's nice that they can provide this for people. And the backings are usually flannel too, so it makes them nice and soft. So yeah, so that was last night. That was fun. That was the first time we've done that. And there was an absolutely gorgeous prize if you won. It was an iron on a, like a holder, sort of like almost like a cake stand. And it was all spray painted gold. And the iron was glued on. And then there was all kinds of crystals and everything all over it. So it was quite funny, actually. So that was fun. I'm sure we'll do that again because it's, you know, it's great. It's fun for everybody. And it goes to a great cause afterwards. So it's surprising what you can get done in just a few hours when you got a bunch of people working together, right? Being organized and stuff. So, Trish Ann has asked me what my favorite applique technique is. I call it raw edge. I call it fusible web applique, but it's raw edge applique. Yeah. Oh my gosh. What needle, thread, or stitch pattern do you prefer? I tend to, okay, so I'm not doing needle churn, right? So that may take that question right off the table, but when I'm using my sewing machine to finish the edges, I typically either do a straight stitch inside, depends on the design, how whimsical it is or what the look is I want for finishing it, or I will often use a very narrow zigzag stitch, not a satin stitch, but getting to that, but very narrow zigzag stitch so you don't see it much. I will use monofilament thread sometimes. It depends on the look I want. I would show you some things, but I'd have to go digging through things right now. But if I use a monofilament thread, then I don't have to change my thread, right? I'll use it on all the pieces. Otherwise, sometimes I'm changing thread colors and I am, you know, I will either pick the same color to go around every element. I'm going like this because usually I do flowers and things. I will maybe have the same thread color that I use, the same thread really. Or if I want to have a contrast, I may use on a light fabric, I may use a dark thread and or vice versa and actually change up the color. So maybe the center of the flower is yellow, I might use an orange on it or a red or something like that. So again, it depends on the look I'm going for in that particular pattern. So it can change. Sharon. Hi, Sharon. It's good to see you too. So we got a bunch of people. Oh, who's popping up here? Trish Ann's just popping up. Monofilament on the top. Thread, good point, top thread. And in the bottom, I like to use, I'm trying to think if he's close enough for me to grab him here. Don't see him. It's called bobbin fill, like a thinner weight, usually a polyester, or I'm not sure if that's a polyester or not, though. Rob will jump in any minute here and tell me, I'm sure. Either that or say we have Wonderfill threads here, so they have a deco bob that's a thinner weight. So some are like 60 weight, 80 weight even, that type of thing. So I'll use a lighter thread in the bottom usually, and it's like a white. You don't usually see it in the top, so hopefully you don't see it in the top. I got my tension right, and I'm trying to think of the other one. Bottom line, superior threads. I know it's superior, I just couldn't think. Bottom line, so again, a thinner thread, and I will use that same color in the bobbin. I typically don't match my threads when I'm doing this. If you haven't heard me say it before, I tend to be lazy when it comes to things like this. I don't, first off, stress over these too much. And if it's easy for me and I'm going to get the project done quicker, that's what I'll go with. So I usually just have a lighter weight thread in the bobbin and just keep that the same, even if I'm using different colors in the top. All right. And for the monofilament, I use the mono poly, the superior threads again too. And it comes in two colors. So it comes in the clear you usually have, and it comes in like a smoke color. So if I'm using darker fabrics, I will go with the smoke for sure. I always try them out first, like I'll unspool it and see, because the monofilaments have a bit of a sheen to them. So it's surprising sometimes if I put the clear one on that I can actually see it more than the darker one, depending on the fabric color. So good to try them out. There we are. Bottom line, 60 weight cotton, Rob is telling me. So there you go. They're all over in another, they're over with my long arm, some of that thread, so I can't grab them here easily, but, don't use monofilament. Some people might tell you can do it. Don't use monofilament in your bobbin. It's not a good idea. Mm-mm. And all my Janome machines, they use plastic bobbins, so trying to wind monofilament on a plastic bobbin is probably not a good idea either, because it can get really tight and it can distort the bobbin, and then it's not going to feed properly. You have all kinds of problems, but monofilament in the bobbin is just not a good idea. Okay, you can disagree with me if you want on that one, but it's just not a good idea. So sometimes when you come down to problems when you're stitching, it's because of what kind of thread you're using, wear on your machine, or you're not using good quality thread. That's another thing I'll say. Use good quality thread. Don't use cheap thread. Don't use old thread. Thread is cheap. Fabric's expensive. Your time is expensive. Your time is worth money, you know? So make sure you use good quality thread and then you don't have half the issues and match your thread weight to the proper needle size too. That's another problem a lot of people will have. Using the wrong size of needle, you're using the wrong type of needle for the thread that you're trying to put it through. So when you match those all up, usually most machines will sew with no issues. So, okay. Other questions, anyone? And I'm waiting for Rob to tell me the normal thing he tells me when I'm live. Okay, Rob, what do you usually say when I'm live, especially if I'm talking about him moderating my machine embroidery group? He will give me a little nudge all the time. So I have a Janome 500E that's just sitting over here. It's ready to be used, but I haven't done much work on it. As a matter of fact, I pulled up some designs the other day, and I have this upcoming week off. I am off work now because we're on spring break for school. So tomorrow I'm live with my Quilters Way people in the afternoon in our Zoom meeting. But next week I have plans to do some actual quilting. One, the charity quilt for Victoria's Quilts, I must get done. And I want to get onto my applique, or my applique, my embroidery machine. I want to do applique on the embroidery machine. So I have some patterns for that already. And I have some other, you know, straight machine embroidery stitches. And I was actually going through some of my designs that come with the machine. I was looking at some of them yesterday. So yes, he says, I'm already feeling guilty about this. Yes, am I feeling guilty? Yes, I am. Actually, I saw, because Janome will put out various blog posts on other sites as well, and they had done, I'm not going to remember, it's a sewing site, but they had done placemats, like linen placemats, and it was really interesting because they took the linen plate, the linen, and cut it, you know, to a little bit bigger than the size they're going to finish with, obviously, but they took ribbon, like clear, like white ribbon, light see-through ribbon, whatever you call it, and they had done some ribbon in different sizes down one side, just stitched it down with a sewing machine on either side, and then they went in with the embroidery machine and picked up one of the designs that's already in the machine. Well, it's not in the machine. It's in the software that comes with the machine. But anyway, you can import it in the machine. It was poppies. And then they did those over top of the ribbon. And it was really, really pretty. I'm like, okay, where's that poppy design? So I had to go into my software and look for it so I could find it because I thought that's really cool. Now, I hadn't thought two things. First off, I hadn't thought about using ribbon in that way. And I have tons of ribbon. So just putting, and it was even different sizes of ribbon. You know, there was a thicker one and a thin. I think they had three or four different lines of the ribbon. So you could stitch that down your machine. You could even stitch it down with decorative stitch if you wanted to. It'd be kind of cool. Or maybe, you know, maybe straight stitch down the edges and a decorative stitch in the middle if it was really plain ribbon. And then putting it in and using the poppy over part of it and then on some of the linen as well. That was really cool. If I find that, I'll put it up in my, I'll remind myself to put that up. I still have it up, I'm sure, in my browser here. And put it up on the Chatterbox Quilts group so you can see what I'm talking about there. Janome placemats. Because it just came out, I think, last week. So I thought, cool, first off, I can use some of my ribbon, and secondly, that'd be a great project for the embroidery machine because I also always say that if you're trying a new technique or something you're not familiar with, start with a small project. So a placemat's a pretty small project to start with. So if things aren't going well, if you haven't wasted a whole bunch of fabric, you haven't wasted a whole bunch of time and stuff. So I think that'd be a really good project to work on. So maybe I'll do that. Okay, so that's about it for today, I think. Reminder again, if you're in Alberta and you're going to Red Deer for the quilt show, the Central Alberta Quilters Guild show, it's a great show. It's one of my favorite shows to go to. I go every year. Lots of vendors. That'll be tough for me this year. But the quilts, there's a lot, amazing amount of quilts from that guild in the surrounding area. And they're all hung, like there's great lighting in the building. There's lots of space. You can step back and get the whole overall look of them and good pictures. So I'll be taking pictures. I'll share those probably on my Chatterbox Quilts group, Facebook group. And yeah, it's really nice. The ladies do a really nice job. It's all run by the guild and they do it every year. So if you're there, I'll be in the food court. It's not even a food court, but the little food area. They set up the tables. They usually have little table decorations on the tables and everything, so they do a really nice job. So I'll be in there about 1 o'clock. So if you're going to be there, pop in and say hi, or if you see me on the show floor, say hi. Be sure, don't be shy. I love meeting some of my online friends. And, oh, the placemats. What do you use inside? Batting, interfacing. I think they had batting inside those. That's usually what I use inside, like just a real flat, you know, 100% cotton. I like to use warm and natural myself. That's what I would use inside. I think that's what they use inside. I wasn't paying attention to the batting so much. I was more looking at the embroidery part of it, but I'm pretty sure they use something like that. Sometimes you might want to use, is it Insulbrite, I think, or even a fusible batting maybe inside if you want to make sure that, you know, the Insulbrite is if you want to make sure that you can have hot things on it. But I would just use plain, flat, cotton batting in there, and that would just work. Yeah, you definitely want something inside them, not just the fabric on top and the bottom. And interfacing isn't going to work that well, I don't think. Usually I use batting inside table runners and placemats. Okay, lots of good questions, Trishan. I like that. I love it when people put me on the spot and I have to think. Sometimes I can think, other days not so much. Okay, so just again, if you are not in my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group, you can go to www.chatterboxquilts.com/FB group, I think. I have to think of, I have so many places where people can go. Yes, it's FB group, and you can join us in there. If you're interested in checking out the Quilters Way and seeing what we do there, I'd love to have you join us there. There's a 14-day free trial, so why not see if it might be for you? And you can find that at thequiltersway.com. There's no www in front of that one. It's just thequiltersway.com. And if you have any more questions, I'll be off live, but I'm still here for you to watch later on. If you're watching the replay and you think of other questions, just pop them in the comments area, and I do watch those later on and reply to them. Next month, it'll be the third week in April. Will that be before or after Easter? I'm not sure, because Easter is really late this year. But I'll see you again on the third Thursday of April at 2 p.m. Mountain Time. All right, guys, thanks so much for joining me here today. I do appreciate it. And we'll see you next month. Have a great rest of your day.